watch them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed morn, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies crying. I watch them grow. They're
to all who are here or at home or watching this in the future, which always seems like a weird thing to say, but welcome whenever it is that you worship with us. And whether you are a member or a visitor, we are so graced by your presence, and I trust that all of you will feel the movement of the Holy Spirit sometime in the next hour. A couple of announcements. Don't forget to read your connections. Also get on the website, there's information there, but Wednesday's the deadline, please, to let the office know if there are people that you would like remembered next Sunday. It'll be our All Saints celebration, and folks will be remembered during worship. So if you have not gotten in any names that you would like remembered, please get those to Terry by Wednesday. It's also the last call to sign up for the Youth Summer Mission Trip. And I saw, there's Ben, I saw Alex, I'm like, Ben's here somewhere. And we have a crowd going, so it's gonna be a good time. So don't miss out if you wanna go, this is last call. And we're starting up yoga classes, 8 o'clock this Wednesday, so before the next Connections comes out. So 8 o'clock here at the church. Where did, in Jones Room, Mindy, I think? In the Jones Room, you'll find them. So come and zen yourself on Wednesday mornings. I have a lot of good news. David Boxall is home from the hospital and recovering, so we celebrate that. And we have a beautiful gift, if you haven't seen it in the narthex, from Sue and Walt Kovalik, a beautiful new lantern that they commissioned as a gift to the congregation. Walt came to a session meeting earlier this fall with a picture and the request. That's how we do things in the Presbyterian Church. The session oversees all property and buildings, so he asked the session to approve this beautiful gift, and it is out in the narthex. So I invite you to take a look at that, and thank Sue and Walt for their generosity. Also, I heard from Andy, many of you here probably could give a better update, but yesterday Bernie's book drive was amazing. They filled so many crates of books that there wasn't room on the truck to take the empty boxes back. Andy said she'd never seen such a drive in the 2.5 years she's been working for them. So thank you for all of you who helped with that. I think these are the kinds of things, I saw the pictures, and what a thing for our neighborhood to see all the cars coming and the big trucks in the parking lot, and that speaks volumes to the community about who you are. So that was a lot of good news. And I do have some sad news to share with you this morning, and that is that Mary Jo Long met Jesus yesterday morning. And she was with her family, so it was, as we hospice chaplains would say, a good death. And she will be celebrated probably before Thanksgiving in this sanctuary, and I will keep you posted when the family decides when that is. But please keep all of Mary Jo's family and dear friends in your hearts and prayers. So this morning is Reformation Sunday, and I just want to talk really briefly. You'll notice many of the elements in the worship bulletin come from our Book of Confessions. And this is actually an old Book of Confessions that I used to study for my ordination exams. And there's a new confession that isn't even in here. You may have heard of the Confession of Belhar, which comes out of South Africa and the situation of apartheid. But this book is part of our polity, which is our governance. This is volume one, which is all of the things that we believe as Presbyterians. It's not how we govern ourselves. That's in the Book of Order, which I know you've all heard. But the Book of Confession starts with the Nicene Creed, has the Apostles' Creed. Those are creeds we share in common with other Christian denominations. And then we come into many of the creeds that were developed during the Reformation and some after. So it's a fascinating collection of what we believe. We believe that we are always reforming. And if you're Presbyterian or Reformed at all, you've heard that sentence. But we're always reforming in the light of the Holy Spirit, meaning we don't just decide something needs to be changed. We listen to the guidance of the Spirit, and then we take our time and we respond to the situation that we think needs changing. So this is this book is where a lot of our worship elements today are coming out of, and Kathy will walk you through. We are not having a personal confession today. We will do an affirmation of faith that comes out of this Book of Confession. So I just wanted to explain some of the worship elements. So with that said, I invite you to join me in our prayer of transition printed at the top of your bulletin. Ever-present God, you call us on a journey to a place we do not know. We are not where we started. We have not reached our destination. We are not sure where we are or who we are. This is not always a comfortable place. Be among us, we pray, and help us to stay on course. Open our hearts to your guidance so that our journey to this unknown place continues as a journey of trust. Amen. And now I invite you to settle your hearts and your minds for the worship of the Lord.
Good morning. Please stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. Let us worship the Holy One of Israel.
Brother.
And as Leslie mentioned, in acknowledgement of today being Reformation Sunday, please join me in the affirmation of faith as printed in your bulletin. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the Church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of peoples long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus," with believers in every time and place. We rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
And so, having affirmed our faith in our triune God, I invite you now to greet each other in that faith. I didn't see any of you if you did. I'm sorry I moved those, I forgot.
Oh,
can sit down. So this morning we are going to jump ahead a bit, not quite as much as we have recently, but we're going to jump ahead and we are in the book of 1 Kings. And we're going to hear excerpts from chapter 5 and chapter 8. And again, I'm going to read from the message because I think the story comes through better that way. So I invite you to just settle in and hear the excerpts from 5 and 8 of 1 Kings about the building of Solomon's temple. Hiram, king of Tyre, sent ambassadors to Solomon when he heard that he had been crowned king in David's place. Hiram had loved David his whole life. Solomon responded saying, "You know that David, my father, was not able to build a temple in honor of God because of the wars he had to fight on all sides, until finally God put them down. Now God has provided peace all around, no one against us, nothing at odds with us. Now here is what I want to do. Build a temple in honor of God, my God, following the promise that God gave to David, my father, namely, your son, whom I will provide to succeed you as king, he will build a house in my honor. And here is how you can help. Give orders for cedars to be cut from the Lebanon forest. My loggers will work alongside yours, and I'll pay your men whatever wage you set. We both know that there was no one like your people for cutting timber." When all of this was finished, King Solomon called in all the leaders of Israel, all the heads of the tribes and the family patriarchs, to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of God from Zion, the city of David. And they came, all Israel, before King Solomon in the seventh month for the great autumn festival. With all Israel's leaders present, the priests took up the Ark of God and carried up the Ark and the tent of meeting and all the holy vessels that went with the tent. King Solomon and the entire congregation of Israel were there at the Ark, worshiping and sacrificing huge numbers of sheep and cattle, so many that no one could keep track. Then the priests brought the Ark of the Covenant of God to its place in the inner sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, under the wings of the cherubim. The outspread wings of the cherubim stretched over the ark and its poles. The poles were so long that their ends could be seen from the entrance to the inner sanctuary, but were not noticeable farther out. They are still there today. There was nothing in the ark but the two stone tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb when God made a covenant with Israel after bringing them up from Egypt. When the priests left the holy place, a cloud filled the temple of God. The priests could not carry out their priestly duties because of the cloud. The glory of God filled the temple of God. Then Solomon spoke. "God has told us that God lives in the dark where no one can see God. I have built this splendid temple, O God, to mark your invisible presence forever." This is the word of God given for the people of God. And I'm looking for kids to meet me. We're going to be very careful, but we're going to meet me down here. Oh, yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you. If you have quarters, feel free to put them up there. Here we go. Let's sit over here today where it's a little, but we're actually going to walk around a tad. Oh, what do you got there? Oh, very fun. All right. Okay, so today's story was about building the temple, the first temple building. Do you know what a temple is?
Yeah.
What is it, Jack?
It's a big pyramid.
It is like a pyramid, right? It's a big building, right? And it's made to honor
God.
So in a way, this is our temple here. Right? We don't call it a temple anymore. What do we call this?
Church,
right? Yeah. But it's the same thing. It's where we come to worship and where we have all our special things that remind us of God. So if you heard in the story, they were carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Did you hear that word a couple times? This is what that looked like. It's this big box, and it was on poles so that people could carry it by holding up the poles. And these are the cherubim. Those are funny winged, they're kind of like angels, but not the way we think of angels. They're really guardians of it. They do, don't they? And they're guarding it to make sure nobody can get inside. And you know what was inside here? The Ten Commandments. Have you heard about those? Yeah. On the stones? You maybe haven't gotten there yet in Sunday school because you're younger. But the Ten Commandments are the laws that God gave to Moses and wrote them on stone. And those were in here. In our reading today, it said that this still sits in the temple. Unfortunately, that's not true anymore because the temple was eventually destroyed. And we don't know where this is. We don't know. It's gone. It's been gone for thousands of years, so we don't know where it is. But it was very, very special to the Hebrew people. So I was thinking we would talk for a little bit about the things in our temple that are very, very special to us, that if we ever moved, Pastor Leslie was actually part of a church that did move, and we took very special things from one church to the new church. If we were going to move from here to another building, what would you think we would want to take with us from this room?
I know.
What, Nick?
God. All those chairs.
The pews, yes. Yeah, places to sit.
The instruments.
The instruments, exactly. We need to sing and be able to raise our voice to God. Jack, what would you take? Bring God, okay, very good. And what might be a symbol of God here?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe that big cross we would take with us?
The whole thing.
The whole thing? That would be great. We actually took the cross down at my old church, and we carried it out. It took six of us, I think, and we carried it out on its side, and we took it down to the new building. So that would probably be one of the first things. Now, I don't know if we can all move around. You want to move around a little bit? What about this thing here? What is this? Do you remember what this is? What happens on this? Communion. You're probably usually in Sunday school when we have communion, huh? But we have our meal, our special meal here. So I think we'd take this. How about this?
Wine.
Wine. And doesn't this look very special?
Wine or water.
Right, it can be both. But usually we have wine in it. Does this look rather special?
Yeah.
I think we'd take this. What do you think?
Water.
Okay. We're making a good list here of things that we would take like the Israelites took. How about over here? Have you ever been in the pulpit? Would you like to stand in the pulpit?
Yes.
Yeah, go right ahead. You can step in. Go ahead. Pastor, Mr. Swan will tell you, Scott will tell you that everywhere we go, Pastor Leslie has to step in the pulpit of other churches. But I'll bet we'd take this, right? And something else I think we would take that would be very important to us is this. Do you know what this is? The big book, exactly. This is our Bible. So I think we'd take that. What?
And that.
The music stands?
Yes.
Okay. I don't know that we can weave our way down here, but this would probably be one of the most important things we would take with us. Do you know what this is? Can you come down and see? It is a bowl. What goes in here?
Quarters.
Nope, quarters go in the basket. Water. And I will bet that a few of you, when you were smaller, maybe even tiny babies, somebody held you around this exact baptismal font. That's what this is called. And we put water in here. And we say special prayers, and then we take the water, and we mark you. You might have been baptized at another church, but it was the exact same thing, and we say the exact same words, so that wherever you're baptized, if it's with water, works in any church you go to.
You're going to a baptism.
Are you going to a baptism? Oh, how fun. I love baptisms. Okay, so these are some of the special things we would take. That's what today's story was about, was the Israelites taking their most special thing into their new church. Does that make sense? All right, let's sit down and pray. You did great staying away from all the wires. Didn't they do great? All right, we invite you all to join us in our prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Have a great day tomorrow, trick-or-treating. Okay? Bye. Sunday school.
from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you. How beautiful. I invite you to join me in prayer. Loving God, settle our busy minds and open our hearts so that each one of us may hear what it is you have to say to us in this time and in this place. And as always, I pray, may my words be your words. Amen. So today's story may seem a little bit odd. We've been hearing stories of how God called particular people into service to help God fulfill dreams that we could never even dream up on our own. Last week we heard the call and anointing of the young boy David, the runt of his family, the herder of sheep out on the hills. Now, David could not ascend the throne immediately because of all that ugly stuff with Saul, but eventually David does come into power as the king of Israel. And as we mentioned last week, while his heart and passion for God never waver, his life and the choices he makes are often quite questionable, if not outright despicable. But he has that deep heart for God that is willing to eventually hear the truth about himself, about all his many flaws, about the terrible missteps that he takes, and then apologize to God first and foremost. In one of the most moving sentences of the Bible, he stares at his confidant and advisor Nathan in the wake of the murderous mess with Bathsheba and declares, "I have sinned against the Lord. It is gut-wrenching and profound on so many levels, and it's that aspect of David's heart and character that we cling to throughout his story, the sordid episodes as well as the inspirational. But there's more to David's heart for God. He longs for the worship of God to be central to the people. During Saul's reign, worship has deteriorated. The ark had actually been captured at one point by the Philistines. Remember, that ark is the ornate box or chest that holds the Ten Commandments on them. It is the word of God, if you will. And under Saul's leadership, it has been neglected, left to languish, and worse, no one seems to care. But David cares. He cares deeply. As king, David seats the capital of the people in the city of Jerusalem as a unifying act. He builds himself a beautiful palace there, and in one of my favorite stories, dances in an undignified manner with joy and abandon when he finally moves the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. Remember, like I showed the kids, it's on poles to be carried. It's the portable temple, and it's actually kept in a tent, an actual tent. And he brings it with great celebration to the newly crowned capital city with the intention of revitalizing worship for the people. Now, after he moves it in, he takes stock of his own personal home and ponders, why am I living in this palatial estate and God's ark sits in a tent in the backyard? This is so wrong. I'm going to build a temple for God, for the ark to have a permanent home. No more of this pitching a tent for the word of God. No, sir, I'm going to do something about this. I'm going to fix this. But God says, not so fast, buddy. Now, seriously, here's David wanting to do this noble thing for the ark and for the people, and God won't allow it. This, to me, is an important piece of David's story because call is not just about what God wants us to do. Call involves listening also for God's no, for God's whisper to let something go, to leave it alone, to understand that that isn't part of your call. And that's basically what God tells David. I will have a temple to my name someday, but not today, and you will not be the one to build it. Ouch. For all that David has done for God, I imagine this no stung deeply. But David being David, he took the news, listened to God, and did not build the temple. Now, God did assure David that a temple would be built, and it would be built by one of his sons, but that's all David knows throughout the rest of his life. That son was Solomon, who we met today. Solomon has become king upon David's death. It's a different sort of ascent to the throne. God did not send Samuel or another prophet to anoint the next chosen king. God seemed content with Solomon as heir to the monarchy and so allowed a more traditional passing of power from father to son. And now it's finally time to build that temple. Please note it is a place for God's name to reside, not God. And this always seems to be a challenge for us human beings. We confuse a thing or a place with reality. And in reality, God does not live in a temple any more than God lives here in this sanctuary. Of course, God is here because God is everywhere. But even when I was growing up as a child, the church was seen as the place where God could be found, right? In Catholicism, we even had the little red flame that burned to show the presence of Christ. In truth, it was to honor the presence of Christ, but that was lost on most of us. We actually thought, oh, Christ is here, when the little red flame was burning. In actuality, if we want to honor the presence of Christ, we need to carry those little red flames everywhere with us. So back in Solomon's time, as in our time, people get confused about where God is, where God lives. Now, Solomon wants to make this an amazing temple, the best the world has ever seen. And that comes out of deep love for God. It comes out of respect for God. It comes from a place of knowing the importance of the task at hand. But like all of us, Solomon gets a bit carried away. His ego takes over, and things don't go exactly as God had planned or hoped. And that is why we are hearing this story today on Reformation Sunday in the Protestant church. I confess to you that when I crossed the street, as I call it, from Catholicism to Protestantism, this whole idea of celebrating the Reformation, well, it was a bit repulsive to me. While it might have been, actually was a necessary event, using the word celebration to describe it didn't sit well with me. It was not something I wanted to celebrate because it created the greatest schism in the church, whose effects continue to ripple through the church. When I was making that move across the street, I discovered at that time there were thousands of different Protestant sects in the United States alone, thousands. But we are hearing the story of Solomon build the temple today because it is Reformation Sunday. Well, why is that again? Well, I keep referring to this narrative lectionary that we're using this year to guide Sunday worship, and in the fall, it's devoted to these Old Testament stories and events. And this new lectionary was created by Lutheran pastors and professors at Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota. Did you get the key word in that sentence? Luther, as in the church that developed out of Martin Luther's 95 calls for reform within the church that he posted back on October 31st, 1517. It was his call for the church to look at itself and change its ways. It was his call for the church to come back to God, remember its purpose and its calling, and reclaim the focus of worship for the people. Sound like David? He wanted folks to remember the reality that God is among us. God is not the building. Well, why was that important? What was all this fuss about? Rome was in a great building phase, and St. Peter's was to become the most beautiful and largest temple ever built to God. You might have seen pictures or been there. It is a feast for the eyes, an overwhelming display of religiosity and grandeur, and it cost a lot of money to build. Money the church did not have. So where to find that financing? Well, one ingenious way was to sell God's love and favor, known as indulgences. Literally buy your forgiveness from God. Assure your place in the heavens after death, all for a mere fee. Yes, innocent folks were duped by priests into paying for their salvation, literally. Paying for their forgiveness, even paying for the salvation of loved ones who had already died. Talk about despicable. Those fees would help finance the building of the largest church in the world. But it would also be the building project that split open and shattered the church. And that is what I always find hard to celebrate, the splintering and schisms of the church. But Luther wasn't out to split the church open. He wanted to reform the church that was, not create a new church. But people being who we are, others would not listen and talk with him without their own agendas and egos getting in the way. How dare he question the bishops of the church and their decisions? How dare he post in open any flaws he found in Mother Church? How dare he threaten the success of their great building project? How dare he? Of course, others jumped into the game as well, and each had their own particular set of grievances with the church, and many of those led to even more splinterings off, which continues to this day when we find thousands of different Christian sects and denominations. So back to the question, why did these Lutheran pastors and professors who created the narrative lectionary choose the building of Solomon's temple for Reformation Sunday? Well, surprise, surprise, the building of the Israelite temple has many of the same characteristics as the building of St. Peter's in Rome. Solomon, as we have seen, wanted the grandest temple to glorify God's name. It's not an unworthy goal. The problem is when our own egos take over and the cost soars, as it did for Solomon. What we did not hear in today's story was how Solomon paid for this exquisite home for God's word. It was built with the help of foreigners with foreign products, which if you know anything about Hebrew law from God, that's a no-no. And it was built on the back of slave labor of the northern tribes of Israel. In other words, the construction of this temple was about as despicable as the construction of St. Peter's. And guess what? Over the next generations, the cost to maintain that temple resulted in such high taxes on the people, the northerners refused to continue to pay, and the kingdom of Israel split. So both the building of Solomon's temple and the building of St. Peter's eventually led to the split of God's kingdom. Well, that's all fascinating, some of you might say. Some of you might say, I don't care, but what's the lesson for us today? Are we building huge, gorgeous, overly ornate churches for the worship of God? Are we paying for our building projects in unchristian and ungodly ways? No, that is not the issue for most of us today. But why did the temple and St. Peter's become the building projects that they did? Because of people's egos. Because people couldn't focus on what was truly important. Because people lost sight of what was important to God. So while their goals may have started out from goodness and love, both projects quickly lost sight of the true purpose, and both projects went off the rails, and both projects ended splitting the kingdom of God. So we ask ourselves today, where have we lost sight of what is important to God? Where have we perhaps split the kingdom? What is our true purpose as the church? And of course, what needs reformation today? Those are questions we need to spend a lot of time with. They won't be answered in a sermon or even a couple of sermons. Why do I say our kingdom has split? Well, we have been split off from the culture, right? We have lost our influence in our society, and we are no longer seen as necessary in the ways of the world. Now, just because the world doesn't see us as necessary doesn't mean that's true. We are so necessary, deeply necessary, especially in the midst of such a hurting and broken world. The question for us is how we get the world's attention, how we step into the current culture, how we find some relevance in a society that doesn't seem to know what relevance means. The building of Solomon's temple and St. Peter's resulted in stunning structures for God, but the people missed the point that God cannot be contained in those buildings. God doesn't dwell in those stunning structures. God cannot be hemmed in or boxed in or contained in any way. So as I reflected on all this past week, I was struck by the irony that as the pandemic ended, we all longed to come back inside our buildings. And I started thinking and wondering about what that meant. Some of it is nostalgia, and I get that. Some of it is the desire for life to seem normal again, and I sure get that. And of course, we wanted to be together, right? To see each other, to share fellowship, to worship together, and I sure understand that. Solomon's temple served as the place where the people turned collectively towards God, but it also served as the center of life for the Israelite community. And I see our church buildings serving that same purpose, providing us a place to collectively turn towards God as a community, but also at buildings that can be the center of life for communities. But there's always that challenge of the little red flame I spoke about earlier from my childhood, the little red light that shone the presence of God. Because we all know that God doesn't live here, God is everywhere. And so in our need to come back inside, to hem ourselves into buildings, it seems contradictory in ways to me. While we need to have a place to collectively turn towards God in worship, we need to ask ourselves, why else do we need this place? How can this lovely facility serve as the center of our Christian lives and community beyond our own membership? What is the purpose of this building? Is it mainly for worship on Sunday mornings? If so, what about all those folks for whom Sunday worship is a challenge or isn't possible? It doesn't work for their lives. How then do we engage and incorporate them into our worship life? And what about the rest of the building outside this beautiful sanctuary? Perhaps we built it for ourselves at one point. That's what most congregations did. But what about now? Are there others that could use some of this space? Are there programs or organizations or services that lack the space they need to do the good things they do? I'm thinking of counseling centers, tech teaching programs. Somebody mentioned to me this week tutoring for all the kids the pandemic has left in the dust. There's a congregation out east that houses a holistic health center. They have a meditation room, they provide space for massage therapists, and they offer yoga classes. At our congregational gathering last Sunday, the idea of finding ministry partners was lifted up, and I think that comment has spurred so many of my thoughts this past week. We cannot allow ourselves to be constrained by the idea that this is the church. We are the church. So wherever we go, we take the church with us. Whatever of ours we share with others, we are sharing the church. So I think we need to face the coming years with hearts for reformation, reforming how we think about church. Is it the building or the people? Reforming where we think church happens. Is it inside these walls here, or is it wherever we take our love for God's people? Reforming even how we think and do worship. Must worship be on Sunday mornings? If we ask ourselves, what is worship and why do we worship, we might be surprised at where those answers will lead us. Heck, we've already learned that worship can be virtual, right? So maybe this will be a reformation that reconnects us. Maybe we need a reformation that isn't about splitting open and splintering, but about reconnecting with God, with God's world, and with the culture around us. Reform means to reshape. It doesn't mean to split or splinter or shatter or toss out. You are in a very unique and gifted place here at PCWS, as you are in the middle of reshaping, reforming already. Not one that you had planned, but that doesn't matter. That's where you are. And so you have a chance to use this transition in radical ways, to see it as an opportunity that it is to reform and reshape yourselves for God's glory. I think you need to be careful in the next months not to long for the ways of the past, because then you may miss the doors of opportunity that God has flung wide open for you through the pandemic and this pastoral transition, doors that can lead to new life and new ways of being church in the world. So how will we reshape PCWS to be able to bring God's love to those around us? How will we reshape the way we use our building to share God's love with others? How will we reshape worship to fit the needs of younger generations? I encourage you to see this time as a gift, to question every return you make from the pandemic, meaning everything you step back into now should be done by first asking, how does this fit the current mission of PCWS? And then, if it does fit the mission, should we be doing it the same way as in the past, or are there new ways that will help us connect with the world better? Let's be like Luther and take a hard look at everything we do and why. And then let's reform and reshape those things that need it, not to splinter off or shatter, but to reconnect to the world. Let's be the reformers that finally get it right. The reformers who end up reshaping the church for good, not splintering it into pieces. Amen. I'm going to invite Kathy into the pulpit to share one of the ways that you all carry that little red flame of the presence of the Spirit out into God's world, a way that you are church outside of these walls in a wonderful way. It's the Word of God. I'll pull out my book of confessions.
I've never been on this side. hola. Buenos dias. Today I bring you greetings from our church family in Cuba, which incidentally is known as the IPRC, Iglesia Presbiteriana Reformada in Cuba, interestingly today. And while we haven't spoken much lately from up here about our friends in Nueva Paz since Izet's visit in January 2020, we continue to have a deep and meaningful connection with our partner church in Cuba. And I just want you to know we haven't communicated a lot of this, but know that throughout the last couple of years, we have been in regular contact with the church, and in particular with our dear friends, Pastor Tirasai and Saskia and Yos Bani, which may be familiar names to many of you. While they and the rest of the congregation are always upbeat, the last 2 years have been very difficult for their country and for their families and for their church. As you no doubt have read in the news, the economic situation in Cuba is very complicated and challenging. Food and medicine are in quite short supply. Access to electricity is unreliable, and there are frequent power blackouts. Hurricanes and heavy rains have destroyed a number of apartment buildings, homes, and already limited crops. And in fact, Pastor Tirasai's parents were forced to leave their small apartment home in Havana after damage from heavy rains in the spring made it unlivable. And in the midst of all this, the Presbyterian Church in Nueva Paz has continued to provide purified water to their community, to feed the elderly, to nurse several members through bouts with COVID and dengue, reopen their church building. They have rebuilt a bathroom. They have restarted work on the manse. They've hosted VBS this summer. They've installed and continue to support a new pastor in their mission church, which is in Vegas, Cuba. And they have distributed many donated medicines, clothing, and school supplies, and they pray for us every Sunday in worship. I also want you to know that we have been pretty creative over the course of the last couple years in finding ways to support this loving and faithful congregation with the gifts that you've given to this particular mission. In 2020, the Mission Committee participated in a U.S. partner-wide fundraising effort to support the Synod, three presbyteries, and each of the individual Presbyterian congregations and their missions in Cuba. And part of the proceeds from this effort in 2020 were used to ship a huge container full of masks, medicines, non-perishable food, powdered milk, and coffee to Havana, which was then distributed by the church's big blue bus to each of the churches throughout the country. In 2021, we were able to send medicines, money, masks, and a pair of prescription eyeglasses to Izet with Pastor Benito, an 80-year-old pastor who has known Tirasai since she was a child and travels to the U.S. frequently for work related to his prison ministry and to visit his daughter in Miami. And in July of this year, we were able to send money, clothing, medicines, and school supplies with a Methodist pastor from the Bronx who has become a friend to us in this mission. Also, Mindy and I continue to work very closely with several other congregations within the Presbytery of Chicago who have partner churches in Cuba. The Community Presbyterian Church in Clarendon Hills, Hope Presbyterian in Wheaton, Southminster Presbyterian in Glen Ellen, First Pres in Libertyville, Fair Oaks Presbyterian in Oak Park, and Fourth Presbyterian Church of Chicago. And together we all form the Havana-Chicago Partnership. We meet regularly, and each year we apply for funding from the Presbytery of Chicago to help support the work of the Presbytery of Havana. So that's the story of the last couple years, the pandemic years, when we dearly missed the opportunity to visit, and those who have gone knows that that's where the magic happens, is when you're able to actually be in Cuba. But thanks to all of your continued faithful support, we have certainly maintained this partnership well. But now, looking to the future, U.S. partners are beginning to visit their Cuban churches, and we hope to begin planning a group visit from PCWS to Nueva Paz sometime this spring or next spring. We will keep you posted, and in the meantime, I would encourage each of you to visit the mission page on the website and to read more about our partners and some of our past trips to Cuba. I can't vouch for the quality of the writing, but the information is there. And by all means, I would encourage everyone to prayerfully consider joining us on a trip to Cuba next year. In the very near future, I will be heading to Cuba next month, joining between 25 and 30 other U.S. partners for the annual meeting of the Cuba Partners Network, with which we've been involved for several years, thanks to Jane Boxall. And I'll be leaving on November 9th for 3 days of meetings and worship and conversation and planning at the Ecumenical Seminary in Matanzas, which might sound familiar to some of you. That's where the oil field fires were. We'll be traveling with fellow U.S. partners, including someone from Fourth Pres downtown, and also with Presbyterian World Mission staff, Cuban church leadership, our friends from Living Waters of the World, and several Cuban pastors. And then I will spend 4 days in Nueva Paz with a group from South Carolina who will be formalizing their new partnership also with Nueva Paz, which opens a whole bunch of new opportunities for us there too. I will gladly deliver your prayers and well wishes to the congregation there and will be most excited to bring Tirasai, a lovely, well-traveled stole with a really neat backstory, as a gift from Pastor Leslie. And in addition, the good news of having another partner in the mix is that they're going to be bringing the medicines this time. So I will be bringing things like mosquito nets, repellent, battery-operated lights, laundry soap, clothing, shoes, all those types of things. And the cost for these items will be covered by the mission committee, but I would also invite anyone who would like to contribute to this part of this mission to feel free to do so by writing a check or online. And also, if you happen to have any gently used women's size 10 low heel black pumps, black gym shoes, or black sporty sandals that you're ready to part with, please let me know. Also, women's lightweight long sleeve cardigan sweaters and men's summer shirts, and very specific, a pair of men's size 10 and a half Keen style sandals would be most appreciated. So as we approach what I think is our 14th year of partnership with Nueva Paz, and at the same time embrace our newly arrived friends and family who have come from Rwanda, I find myself wondering, how is it that we are all so blessed with such unique and wonder-filled opportunities to share God's love with others? Together, our congregation has such a capacity to welcome, to share, to love, and to be God's light in the world in so many different ways. Imana igue umugisha, and Dios los bendiga. God bless you.
I invite you to join me in prayer. Reforming God, we do give you thanks for your forgiveness and for all of your abundant blessing. We pray for ourselves and your church throughout the world. Fill us with a spirit of openness to your spirit, to hear and receive your promises, and to keep our covenant with you. Your love and grace are like streams of water in the desert. Your joy comes splashing down upon us. You refresh and renew us like rain coming down on the earth. Bring your restoring water of life to us. Help us to always seek to reshape and reform your church in the light of your Holy Spirit. Where we are corrupt, purify us. Where we are in error, direct us. Where we are in need, provide for us. Where we are divided, unite us. And where we are closed-minded, reform us and make us new. Where there are wars, bring your peace. Where there is starvation, fill the empty bellies. Where there is despair, bring your hope. Where there is animosity, bring your reconciliation. Where there is abuse, bring your tender mercies. Where there is poverty, bring charity. Where there is illness, bring healing. Where there is grief, bring consolation and gentleness. Where there is injustice, bring justice. This morning we ask specifically for prayers for our Nueva Paz family and for Kathy and the others that will travel to Cuba. May your spirit accompany all, embrace all in their meetings together, prove to be a fruitful time for them. Bring some respite from all that they have been suffering these last 2.5 years. And this morning we ask for prayers for all those who loved Mary Jo Long. May they find consolation and comfort in your love, knowing that she now sits at your divine banquet table. And as always, we lay our prayers at your heart in the name of the Christ. Amen. And now we get a chance to reflect on our thanks and gratitude for the abundance that has been showered upon us as members of that one body of Christ. So I invite you to listen to the offertory meditation as you reflect on all that you are thankful and grateful for in your life and also in this wonderful congregation. I invite you to stand and join me in our unison prayer of dedication and thanks. Generous God, over and over your grace sustains us. Over and over your love provides for us. Over and over your arm steadies us. We give you these gifts with gratitude and joy, thankful that you are God over all. Amen. Well, you have work to do with me this morning. You are part of the benediction, so if you don't have your bulletin, please grab it. What is our only comfort in life and in death?
That we belong to God's soul in life and death, not to ourselves, but to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ.
What is our chief end in life? I bless you in the name of that God, and I send you out into the week to enjoy God and glorify God. Amen, friends. And thank you to the No Name Band. Thank you so much.